Good morning, folks. Mike, thank you for that. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Whew, it doesn't get any better than that. And that last song that you sang, I'd never heard it before, but I love it. That's what I would call an instant favorite. And that's because of the lyrics. It says it all. That's a sermon in a song, actually. Well, I want to thank Paul and Adam for teaching while I was traveling for the last 2 weeks, and I'm so thankful to have these men here that are capable of doing that, and I can be comforted and rest assured that things are going to keep right on moving forward as they should. I've made that statement many times before. The sign that a fellowship is the work of God and being led by the Holy Spirit is that it doesn't miss a beat whether the pastor's there or not, because it isn't about the pastor. It's about you as God's people gathering together on a weekly basis and worshiping the Lord. And whether I'm here or not, that shouldn't change. And so I'm very thankful for those men, and I know that you were encouraged and edified. I heard from some of you to that effect, and so again, thank you, Paul and Adam. Last weekend, Kathy and I were in Dallas, Texas at the Hear the Watchman conference. It was a great honor for me to be invited to speak there, and I, along with 16 other speakers that I'm familiar with. Some people are not. They should be, and I've encouraged you over the years to become familiar with these people. Now, an interesting thing about it is that on Soaring Eagle Radio, I've interviewed probably 80% of them. So if you're interested in finding out more about the ministries, some of the speakers that are listed, then you can go to Hear the Watchman, I think, hearthewatchman.com. And you can see some of those speakers are, but you'll see that they've appeared on Soaring Eagle Radio. So I'm familiar with them, friends with a handful of them, friends to the extent that we spent time together last weekend over a meal and just chatting and sharing updates on where we're at and what we're doing ministry-wise, what the Lord is saying to us and where He's leading. But one of the exciting things that came out of that weekend is always more ministry opportunities open doors for future collaboration with speakers and ministries. And so I'm looking forward to what the Lord might do. I was on the phone last night and yesterday with a couple of different people talking through some of these things. And it's very exciting. Very exciting to see, and I won't go into detail with any of that at this point, other than to say that I'm looking at trying to pull together a conference here in July. I don't know that it'll work in July. Some of the folks I've been chatting with have commitments, and then I know we have VBS in July, and is that the week of the 7th? 10th, okay. That might be a little hard to manage, so we may look at August for that. But some of the folks that I'm reaching out to, you'll be blessed to hear them speak and become aware of their ministries. And some of you are already aware of their ministries. So anyway, that's coming up. I really wanted to just give an overview, and what you're seeing up here, this slide. That's an article that I wrote the other day, just based on thinking about the conference and the speakers and what message they brought. So I refer you to my blog site, drmikespaulding.com. You can go there and read this article, Reflections on Hear the Watchman Conference in Dallas. And that'll give you just a brief synopsis of what went on this past weekend. One of the things that I was very encouraged by, and I probably leaned, I didn't speak till Sunday, so I got to listen to every speaker. I think I was 14 out of 16 So I got to sit and listen to all of these speakers before me, and it was fabulous. It was wonderful to just sit and be fed and to take it in. But a common theme, and I must have leaned over to Kathy and said, that points in my presentation. That points in my presentation. That points in my presentation. All these speakers, at least 40 times, I must have said, that points in my presentation. And what that confirmed for me was that, and we didn't work together, there was no theme. There was no, hey guys, let's focus on this. It was just, you bring whatever the Lord lays on your heart. And so we did that, but the common theme through it all was this. The world will know that you are His by the love that you have for one another. The world will see that you belong to Jesus Christ by the love that you have among the brethren. The reason why that is so important today is because it's becoming increasingly scarce and increasingly difficult. And that's a mystery to me as I consider that. Why is it that we have such a difficult time loving one another? It is a command of the Lord. How many times did the Apostle John alone say, if you say that you love the Father but you have no love for the brethren, the love of God is not in you. And in fact, I would suggest that based upon the Scriptures, that you're a false convert. You're a false convert. You cannot love the brethren but claim to love God. There's something wrong with that. There's something not in balance. And I would say that the Holy Spirit is not living within you. I would encourage you, and I've been to, Kathy and I were saved in 1983. Wow, I know. I wasn't even born in 1983. I saw some of your eyes get that big. 1983! Wasn't that back when dinosaurs roamed the earth? Not quite. Dinosaurs roamed the earth when Tom was saved. I'm just kidding. We've heard Tom's testimony. 1949. Anybody saved before 1949? I didn't think so. I wasn't even born in 1949. Judy was. She was roaming the earth in 1949. Kathy and I, over the years, we've been to a lot of conferences, folks. I mean, a bunch. Only a handful of them, looking back now, were worthwhile. And even fewer of that handful really were impactful. In other words, God's Spirit was so in charge and in control that every speaker was moving and speaking in harmony with what the Holy Spirit was saying to us. This weekend in Dallas was one of those. In fact, I would put it right at the top. And again, we've been to a lot of conferences, but I've never been to a conference where the Holy Spirit was in control from start to finish. Maybe it's because of my wiring. Maybe I'm sensitive to this. I don't know. But I go into things like this, and I'm wary. I'm wary because I've got about that much tolerance for ego. And it seems like God, and sometimes it feels, Lord, why? I mean, can I not have this discernment, please? I'm very sensitive to what's become what I call, anyway, in Christendom in America today, the cult of personality. You know, the rock star pastor. And the ego that goes along with that. One of the statements that I made as I got into my message, and by the way, since you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn with me to 1 Corinthians. This will be the launching point for some of the thoughts I want to share with you this morning. 1 Corinthians, and we are going to be in chapter 1, so you don't have to turn any further than that. Now, we are going to do an old-fashioned Bible study, so we'll be going through some passages of Scripture that will support what I'm going to be sharing. But 1 Corinthians chapter 1. What happens, folks, what I've observed over the years is that when speakers, ministry heads, pastors, when they're elevated and put on pedestals, a train wreck normally ensues. How many of you understand that the only one that we should be lifting up and exalting is the Lord Jesus Christ? It is not his servants. It should never be his shepherds. Now, God calls people to shepherd local fellowships, and that is a high and holy calling. I'm not trying to demean that at all. But what we must not do is to become a follower of men. You must never think that any person on the face of the earth is infallible. You must always do your due diligence in studying the Scripture. Why? To show yourself approved unto the Lord, a workman who will not be ashamed. See, that verse isn't given for just to pastors. It's given to every believer. It's your responsibility to study the Scripture, to understand what it says, to know truth as presented in the Scriptures, and to reject false teaching. That is your responsibility. And it's your responsibility to make sure that the shepherd that you have placed yourself under is doing likewise. Why are so many churches in apostasy today? Because the congregation sitting under that shepherd just receives everything that he says. That is a tragedy. So my presentation was aimed at equipping the remnant body to understand that we are in the age of apostasy. But during the age of apostasy, God does an amazing thing that we see in the Scriptures. He also strengthens and raises up a remnant. He holds a body in his hands, a group of believers that he strengthens by the anointing and the power of his Holy Spirit to stand up and stand firm and stand out and speak out against apostasy. So as I was thinking about that, leading up to the conference, the Lord placed this verse on my heart. And so let's look at 1 Corinthians 1, the very first question or statement of verse 13. Look what it says. Has Christ been divided? Has Christ been divided? When you understand that within the context of what Paul is writing, he wrote three or four letters to the Corinthians. We only have two of them. We know there were more, but they were not preserved. And that was God's supernatural providence on display. For some reason, they were not to be included in the canon of Scripture. But Paul's letters to the Corinthian believers, interestingly enough, were all wrote to correct carnality in the church. Carnality in the church. And I always like to point this out, especially when I do wedding ceremonies, because one of the most well-known passages of Scripture is found in 1 Corinthians. What chapter is it? 13. Everybody knows that. That's right. Chapter 13. What do you call 1 Corinthians chapter 13? You have a name for that? The love chapter. Yeah, exactly. Well, we would like to have 1 Corinthians 13 read during our ceremony. Hey, that's great. It's a great rebuke. Rebuke? What are you talking about? Well, Paul wrote that because they were not being lovely. He said, this is what real godly love looks like, which, by the way, is not what you're manifesting. Go back and read it in context. Remember, it is not my responsibility to protect you from your Bible. The Bible says what it says. 1 Corinthians 11, we read that all the time before we receive the elements of the Lord's table, don't we? Did you know that Paul wrote that because they were not observing the Lord's table correctly? They had turned the agape feast and the Lord's table into some kind of nonsense where all the wealthy people and those that got there early would participate in it, and those who had little to bring to the agape feast or got there late didn't get to participate. You can read it in the letter, 1 Corinthians. Paul talks about all this stuff. He talks about the gifts of the Spirit, the gifts of tongues and all these things. Well, why did he write instructing them on those? Because they were not manifesting them correctly. And here, has Christ been divided in verse 13, it's preceded by a very telling statement. Look at verse 12. Paul says, well, go back to 11 for context. For I have been informed concerning you, my brethren, by Chloe's people, that there are quarrels among you. Again, carnality. Verse 12, now I mean this. Here's what I mean specifically. That each of you is saying, I'm of Paul, and I'm of Apollos, and I'm of Cephas, and I'm of Christ. What are they saying? Well, I follow Adam, or I follow Paul, or I follow Mike, or I follow Mark, or he's my shepherd, or this guy's my shepherd, or I follow his teaching. I follow John Piper, I follow John MacArthur, I follow Chuck Smith, I follow... Paul says, has Christ been divided? What do you mean you're following a man? We're to follow Jesus. Has Christ been divided? Well, as I thought about that, in light of a message that I could bring during this conference, I realized that that goes on today. It goes on today most clearly in what is called, and of course they're like a chameleon. They keep changing their colors and they keep slithering along. But the so-called emergent church, the contemplative, mystical, ecumenical movement, all of those things. And if you study this in our religious culture, brothers and sisters, you'll see that there's a coming together, if you will, of all these different really heretical systems of thinking that call themselves Christian, but they really are not. Here's what they all have in common. Same chapter, verse 18. 1 Corinthians 1, 18. Here's what all of these movements that are coming together have in common. For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Here's a common denominator today that I see in all these false teachings. They're marginalizing in the least and completely obscuring or denying the necessity of the crucifixion, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Well, how are they doing that? How many of you understand that the biblical teaching of the atonement of Jesus Christ, his work on Calvary's cross to cleanse us of all of our sin, is not only under attack, but in many places is being denied? Did you know that? It's happening. It's happening. People are denying the necessity of the death of Jesus Christ. In fact, some have taken to referring to the atonement or the cross, the crucifixion, the death of Jesus Christ, they've taken to referring to that as an act of barbarism. Have you heard that? I have. It's out there. An act of barbarism. One emergent writer, and I'm not going to name his name because I'm not 100% sure that it was him, but one of the key figures in the so, and I hesitate to refer to them as emergent anymore because that's like a 15-year ago label. They've kind of slithered in and attached themselves to other things now. They're trying to get away from this umbrella called the emergent movement. But really what they are is Christ denying. But they've come to categorize the crucifixion of Jesus as cosmic child abuse. People who profess Christ, say that they are believers, are now referring to what Jesus did on our behalf as cosmic child abuse. I would encourage you to study this on your own. So has Christ been divided? The whole point is this. Yes, he has and continues to be among the apostates. How many of you understand that the one thing that a cult or a false teaching will always do is denigrate the Lord Jesus Christ, his person or his work in some fashion? That's how you can always tell you're dealing with a cult. Because they will, in some sense, attack the person or the work, the deity of Jesus Christ. See, that's the one thing that we hold in common. A common belief, a common understanding that Jesus Christ, the pre-incarnate Son of God, God in the flesh, came down, left his place in glory, took on human flesh, and lived a sinless life, gave his life as a ransom for many, died on our behalf, took upon himself the penalty that sin requires. And what is the penalty of sin? Death. That the scripture says, for the wages of sin is death. He took that upon himself for us. So you know you're dealing with a cult with a false belief system, something that's antithetical to true Christianity, when they attack the person, the work of Jesus Christ. And so I made this point, and then I went on and I shared some tactics. Having a military background, I can recall when I went through my training and some of the tactics that they shared with us. And it was especially important for folks that served in my particular MOS. Let's see if I can remember what that stands for. Military Occupational Specialty, or something of that nature, I think. Does that sound right, William? What it means is, what's your job? You know, the military always confuses everything. They always make it much more difficult than it needs to be. But I was one of those guys that snuck around at night and went places you shouldn't go and saw things that most people wouldn't see, and then you came back and you told the guys, and then the big guns would go in. That sums it up pretty much. And so I was thinking about that tactics. What I learned many, many decades ago. And how that relates to the Christian life. Because you understand, don't you, that we are in a spiritual war. All of life is a spiritual war. Do you know that when you are born again, when you become a son or daughter of the Most High God, that you are automatically enlisted in His army? This isn't an optional thing. Now, some people treat it like it's optional, and they refuse to become involved or engaged. But brothers and sisters, the Christian life, and this is becoming so clear today, I don't know how people can miss it. The Christian life is all about spiritual warfare. And that's why we're encouraged so many times to read the Scripture, to study the Scripture, to meditate on the Scripture, to be in prayer, to exercise spiritual disciplines such as fasting and other things. Some people think, well, that'll make me a better Christian. Well, that's a byproduct. All of these things and spiritual disciplines that we're encouraged to do will make us a better soldier, will make us more aware of what's going on in the world today. You've heard me say this before. There is no other explanation for the events that we see transpiring all across the globe than that Satan is throwing a temper tantrum. We are involved in such demonic activity globally. There is no other explanation. Does it not seem like the world has been turned upside down on its head? People have lost their minds. Well, it's no coinky dinky that it's all happening at the same time. And you can believe what you want about this past election. I happen to believe that God hit the pause button for the church. Because I happen to believe that if the globalists, even though part of me says, well, they got their way anyway with Mr. Trump, if the globalists would have got their way and Hillary Clinton would have been in there, churches like ours would be on the clock. And what I mean by on the clock is on the clock to closing. You can believe something else if you prefer. We find ourselves in some very, very strange times. Christ is being attacked, the very foundation of the true church. I found, interestingly enough, a couple of days before we left to go to this conference, I received in the mail results from a survey from the Barna Group, and a couple of years ago, I received an email out of the blue from the Barna Research Group and asked me to participate. Would I be interested in participating in surveys? Sure. Does it only take 10 minutes of your time when they come out? They're periodic, maybe half a dozen a year. And after the first couple of surveys that I answered and all online, all electronic, I thought, wow, this is really going to skew your results. And some of the questions that they ask. Because you know how statistics work, right? They're looking for the mean. And the outliers, those responses on the extreme, they get tossed. So I'm thinking, well, you're going to toss my responses every time I answer because... But here was an interesting survey. And I'll just share a little bit of the results because I think, well, this in part explains why we are where we are today. In a nationwide survey of adults, the Barna Group survey discovered that only 2 out of every 10 adults, 2 out of every 10, 20%, believe they have a personal responsibility to share their faith in Christ with others who believe differently. The research found a high degree of consistency between people's lack of a sense of responsibility and their engagement in evangelism. Well, of course. Among adults, only 23% shared their personal faith on a monthly basis during the past year. Now, if that number isn't troubling enough, this one really, and you can see I highlighted it and made some numbers because I love lists. And this makes for a good list. But I highlighted it because this was even more troubling. Only 23% shared their personal faith on a monthly basis during the past year. What was more troubling was the content of what they were sharing. The survey results among adults suggested that all kinds of divergent ideas about the Christian narrative are conveyed to people, non-believers. Among the concepts most likely to be shared by conservative believers are, one, that people are basically good. What's our response to that? I did that, by the way, at the conference, and by the time there's like nine of these, by the time I got down to number three, everybody was doing that. It's like, wow, that catches on pretty quick. People are not basically good. People are born sinners. And if we teach people that there's nothing wrong with you as you are, why do they need a Savior? Secondly, the content of what these 23% of people are sharing, that having some faith is more important than the substance of that faith. Yeah, faith and faith. I think that's a direct result of word faith. Faith and faith. Listen, do you not understand that your faith must have an object? Three, that God exists and is omnipotent and omniscient, but that humankind has evolved from other life forms. That goes beyond theistic evolution, folks. This is like panspermia kind of nonsense. You know, aliens seeded the planet. Which, by the way, my personal opinion is that people are being set up in our culture to believe that. And that way, when the Antichrist appears, he'll be readily accepted. They shared that God remains aware of what happens in the universe and is involved in our lives. Okay. It's kind of milquetoast, but that's... That absolute moral truth... That there is absolute moral truth, but it is located in various places. That's another way of saying all paths lead to God. There is truth in Hinduism, there is truth in Buddhism, there is truth in Shintoism, there is truth in Islam. Eternal security can be assured either through the sacrificial death and resurrection of Christ or by doing enough good deeds to earn God's favor. Again, if I can do enough good deeds to earn God's favor, I don't need Jesus. That a person's life can be considered successful based upon the personal goals accomplished. That's the health and wealth prosperity gospel. The Bible is the reliable word of God. No, that's right, most of the time. It's pretty reliable. Jesus understands our struggle because he sinned while on earth. Heresy, yeah. Sin is real, but Satan and the Holy Spirit are not. Wow. And there is more, but I will not continue that. If you're interested in that, I'd be happy to send you that electronically. We have, brothers and sisters, a lot of issues within Christendom today. And sometimes we get blinders on And we think that everything's good because everything's good in our world. And what we fail to understand is that everything is not good in the world. One of the themes, again, that emerged was our great need to love one another within the body of Christ. But a second and parallel truth that emerged through many of the speakers was this, that being a disciple of Jesus means we make disciples of Jesus. Being a disciple means we make disciples of Jesus. And I want to be clear about that. Turn with me, and we'll come back to 1 Corinthians if time permits, but turn with me to Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, the very last chapter, chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. Amen. Look at, let's go to verse 18, towards the end. You know this passage of Scripture very well. Notice what it says here. And this is just before he ascended into heaven. Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Now, we know that passage of Scripture, don't we? It is called the Great Commission, right? It is not called, as some say, sarcastically, the Great Suggestion. It's called the Great Commission. Now, there are many points in this passage that deserve to be really highlighted. And so I call your attention to verse 18. Jesus says, "All authority has been given to me." All authority has been given to me. That implies, brothers and sisters, that as he sends you out to share the gospel and to make disciples, that you are going out under the authority and the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand then that it's not something that we should be fearful of, that we should be anxious about, but we should go forth and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with boldness, because we are doing so under the authority and by the power of Jesus. The Holy Spirit living within us, brothers and sisters, will direct our paths, open the doors that need to be opened that we might walk through them, put people right in front of us that need to hear the gospel. I can't tell you how many times that's happened in these last few months. I'll share at another time, perhaps. Kathy and I, we are in a place in our lives where it's just head-shaking time. And I don't know how else to explain it other than we are just marveling at what God is doing. I just shake my head every day at the things that God is doing in our lives. And the people that he's putting in front of me, or that he's putting me in front of. It can only come by the hand of the Lord. So the power, the authority of Jesus is ours as we go out into the world and make disciples. But I want you to notice that we are to make disciples of Jesus. Well, of course, Mike. There are many today who are making disciples of themselves. Back to 1 Corinthians 1:13, has Christ been divided? Do you understand that there are pastors who are building their own earthly kingdoms? They're making disciples of themselves. Jesus said, "You will make disciples of me." We must always point people to Jesus. Always. And that's why it's kind of curious to me when people get upset and stomp off and you never see them again. It's like, what exactly is the issue? Have we not exalted the Lord Jesus? Have we not pointed people to the Lord Jesus? If you have a problem with me or someone else, talk to that person. The world will know that you belong to Him by the love that you have for one another. It's not loving to cop an attitude or to get in the flesh and stomp off. Now, if we're not teaching Jesus, if we're not exalting the name of Jesus, then you have every right to say something. Otherwise, you're in the wrong. And anything that you say and you open your mouth after that fact, you are sinning. That's the sin of gossip. So I was thinking about that as I was working on this message for the conference. And it's like, how many pastors are making disciples of themselves? And then notice the second thing that it says. It says it in verse 20. Teaching them, these disciples, you are to teach them all that Christ commands. You know what that means? That means pastors and Bible teachers and ministry leaders, you have a highway that you stay on. You drive in the lane. You don't go off-roading and four-wheeling through the mud, as fun as that might be for them. You stay on the highway. What is the highway? Well, it's the Scriptures. It's the Bible. It's what Jesus taught. Well, what is off-roading and four-wheeling and going all these other paths? Well, that's all the hobby horse theologies that pastors seem to like to go to. It always ends up back at a particular place for many pastors. Why? Because that's their hobby horse. We concluded the conference in Dallas with a panel. People have submitted questions that they asked. And one of the questions, and I got a doozy. Well, I got two that were. But one of them was this. Well, how in the world do you teach on some of the subjects that have been taught during this conference? And you have to realize that some of the speakers there, like L.A. Marzulli. Are you familiar with L.A. Marzulli? I know some of you are. And some of the speakers teach, their ministry really focuses on what mainstream Christianity refers to as the fringe. Fringe subjects. And so the question was this: how in the world do you incorporate what we've been talking about this whole conference and this weekend, how you incorporate that into the normal flow of the Scriptures and Bible teaching? And I said, well, that's very easy. You teach the Scriptures in context. We get in trouble, you see, when we leave the context behind and we begin to formulate what the Scripture has to say based on what we want it to say. Because I've got a hobby horse theology and I want the Scriptures to support what I think. How many of you know that's backwards? See, it's not the Scripture that has to change if you bump up against what the Scripture says. Well, I've got a different idea about what the Scripture says, and so the Scripture needs to change. Well, too many shepherds do that. And they deny the clear teaching of what the Scripture says. They won't do the study because they don't want to know. And so I said, well, you just teach the Scripture in context. Here's an example. Genesis 6. What does it say? The sons of God were not the godly line of Seth, brothers and sisters. The church has been taught that for so long. It is simply not true. The grammar of the passage itself does not allow for it. The words themselves do not allow for that. And so I said, you just teach the scripture in context. If you teach it in context, you don't ever have to worry about abusing the scriptures. And so we are to teach what Jesus taught. We are to make disciples of Jesus. We are to teach what Jesus taught. And we are to do that. And I started, this is the third point, but it was really expressed in verse 18. We are to do it under the power and the leading of the Holy Spirit. How many of you understand that if you operate outside the power and the leading and the direction of the Holy Spirit, that the enemy is going to knock you out? The enemy is going to take you out. And I pointed out, and I want to point out this morning, that there's a glaring vacuum. There's something that's missing here in verses 18 through 20. Let's read through it again. Jesus says, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you." All means all. He didn't say, teach them those things that are culturally acceptable. Teach them those things that aren't hot button issues. Teach them those things that won't offend or upset anyone. Teach them all that I commanded you. And I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. So what's absent from that passage of Scripture? There's no mention of being overly concerned about offending people. That seems to be a major focus of much of Christendom today. Well, we can't do that because that'll offend people. People will be offended by that. Well, we can't take a stand on that. I actually heard of a pastor that I consider him a friend. But someone went to him and said, how are we going to address this issue of transgenderism and what's going on in our culture today? And he said, I'm not. Are you serious? I'm not? That's the response? One day before the previous Barna survey hit my email, I found this article. And this is all, these all came to me as I'm finishing up the presentation to go to Dallas. And I'm thinking, thank you, Lord, this is exactly what I need to insert at this point. And this is an article that Dr. Mike Brown wrote. And I don't agree with everything that Dr. Brown writes, but he hit the nail on the head on this one. And the name of the article that he wrote, and he incorporated these Barna survey results, is called Fear in the Christian Pulpit. Fear in the Christian Pulpit. So he says, in 2014, George Barna discussed the results of his latest poll during an interview on American Family Radio. He explained that, quote, "What we're finding is that when we ask pastors about all the key issues of the day, 90% of them are telling us, yes, the Bible speaks to every one of these issues." And then we ask them, well, are you teaching your people what the Bible says about those issues? And the numbers drop, are you ready for this, to less than 10% of pastors who say they will speak about those issues. 90% acknowledge that the issues are there and the Bible speaks to them, but less than 10% say, no, we're not going to say anything about that. And what exactly holds them back from addressing controversial issues from the pulpit, including societal, moral, political issues? According to Barna, there are five factors that the vast majority of pastors turn to and the reasons why they won't address issues from the pulpit. Are you ready for these? I should have passed out barf bags before I... Here's why the vast majority, five factors. Attendance, giving, programs, number of staff, square footage. In other words, the campuses, their earthly kingdoms they've built up that come with a huge mortgage. We can't speak out about that stuff. If we do that, people will stop coming. And if people stop coming, they'll stop giving. And if people stop giving, then we'll have to cut programs. And if we have to cut programs, then people will stop coming, and we just won't be as effective as we have been. Nonsense. What's going on in America today in too many places is you have corrals, earthly kingdoms that people are building up, and they're really nothing more than corrals for goats. If you build an attractive enough building and you offer enough programs that people like, they'll come flooding into your services. Just don't talk about Jesus. Unless you're going to talk about him in a nice way. You know. I find it interesting, though, that Jesus referred to himself as a stumbling block. Jesus referred to himself as a rock of offense. You see, the only people that will stumble over Jesus are those that are perishing. 1 Corinthians 1:18. For the word of the cross is foolishness to those that are perishing. Brothers and sisters, we have one mandate. And that is to make disciples of everyone that we come in contact with through the preaching of the gospel, through the teaching of the whole word of God. When Jesus says that you are to teach them all that I commanded you, do you understand that's the entire Bible? Well, how can you say that? Jesus is only in the New Testament. Are you kidding? Jesus is the Word. Jesus is the Word. It is, Jesus is spoken about, and I don't have time to go through it. He is spoken about where we see a type of Christ in every book of the Bible. A picture of him in every book of the Bible. How foolish it is for us in our nation today, and many have jumped on this bandwagon. How foolish it is for us today to talk about making America great again, unless we are willing to recognize one thing. Until God is made great again, America will never, ever be great again. And God cannot be made great again as long as we have churches that are being run by apostates. As long as we have churches that are full of goats and not sheep, the church will never be great again. We need to get our spiritual houses in order, brothers and sisters. And I pray that you will join me in praying for a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit in our last days. That God will come upon us in such a fashion here in Calvary Chapel of Lima that we cannot contain it. That it will pour out of us, as Jesus said, rivers of living waters will flow out of us. That we'll take the mandate of Christ seriously, and we'll go into our workplaces, and every time that door cracks a little bit for us to share Jesus, we're going to share Jesus. And I used to say, direct them to a Bible-teaching, Bible-preaching, Bible-believing church. And I still do it, but I'm inviting people here. And I'm not apologizing for that. And the reason that I'm inviting people here is because I can't in good conscience send them to any other place in this city. Now, I know there are a church or two in this city that they are faithful. I just don't know them personally. But I'm not stupid enough to believe that we're the only place in Lima that's being faithful to the Lord. There has to be. And I would love to know those churches so that we can, with a clear conscience, refer. Because this isn't for everybody, is it? Where's Larry? He's teaching. Larry always tells, he cracks me up, especially when somebody's visiting for the first time. That's one of the first things out of his mouth. Hey, it's not for everybody. It's like, well, thanks, Larry. You just cut to the quick. Why isn't it for everybody? Because most people will not sit for an hour, bless you folks, and listen to the expounding of the scriptures. They won't sit and listen to that because that's not what they think they need. But it is exactly what they need. I pray for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And as God answers that prayer for us, and He uses us, let's remember, folks, that we have a calling to be on the front lines. The front lines of social conflict, advocating for the lives of unborn children, advocating for the sanctity of marriage between a man and a woman, advocating for the truth that God created them male and female, not confused, advocating for that, sharing that. Now, when you do, and as we do, you're going to get blowback. That comes with the territory, doesn't it? I'll close this morning with this. And again, this was from Kathy and my devotional. The week before we left for Dallas. And I thought, oh, I got to take this with me and read this. Because Kathy and I, this year we're using a Tozer, a W. Tozer devotional. Last year we did one on all the hymns. It was great. Well, you remember because I probably shared a lot of that. This is from A.W. Tozer, and this was from March 20th and 21st, which was just a few days before we left to go to the conference, and I thought, oh, man. How'd you like to start your day reading this? Talk about eating your Wheaties before you go to work. You younger people, that's lost on you. You don't remember this. Tozer wrote this. He said, a prophet is one who knows his times and what God is trying to say to the people of his times. Today we need prophetic preachers. Not preachers of prophecy merely, but preachers with a gift of prophecy. The word of wisdom is missing. I got a word of wisdom last night from a guy I was talking to in Texas. Becoming a dear brother. We need the gift of discernment again in our pulpits. Amen. It's not the ability to predict that we need, but the anointed eye, the power of spiritual penetration and interpretation, the ability to appraise the religious scene as viewed from God's position and to tell us what is actually going on. That's what we need in our pulpits today, brothers and sisters. Men who are not afraid to say this is what's going on in our culture from a biblical perspective, wake up and see, and then respond accordingly. What is needed desperately today is prophetic insight. Scholars can interpret the past. It takes prophets to interpret the present. Learning will enable a man to pass judgment on our yesterdays. But it requires a gift of clear seeing to pass judgment on our own day. If Christianity is to receive a rejuvenation, it must be by other means than any now being used. You want to find in the scriptures any place where we're commanded to throw a Super Bowl party for goats to come in and feel comfortable in the presence of God's people and hope they'll come back for a Sunday service? That's not evangelism. That's compromise. You won't find in the scriptures any place where it says, hey, You'll really get the people engaged if you put on a rock concert before the teaching. You know, stage lights, fog machines. People dressed really cool, hipster, and rocking out. May that never be. Music before teaching is only meant to encourage worship. Singing songs, brothers and sisters, is not worship. Please hear me. Worship is what transpires between your heart and the Lord. It is a spiritual thing. Getting caught up in music is an emotional thing. Please don't mistake the two. If the church in the second half of this century is to recover from the injuries she suffered in the first half, there must appear a new type of preacher. Any kind of religious leader must arise. Another kind of religious leader must arise among us. He must be of the old prophet type, a man who has seen visions of God and has heard a voice from the throne. When he comes, and I pray God there will be not one but many, he will stand in flat contradiction to everything our smirking, smooth civilization holds dear. Man, I about hopped up out of my recliner that morning and said, I'm ready, let's go. He will contradict, denounce, and protest in the name of God and will earn the hatred and opposition of a large segment of Christendom. Do you understand, brothers and sisters, that in a good many places the enemy is already in the gate? The enemy has already conquered that local church. They're in full-blown apostasy. And they're not going to like the message that God's true messengers, God's true servants have to say. They're not going to like that. Such a man is likely to be lean, rugged, blunt-spoken, and a little bit angry with the world. He will love Christ and the souls of men to the point of willingness to die for the glory of the one and the salvation of the other, but he will fear nothing that breathes with mortal breath. Brothers and sisters, we live in an opportune time. See, I don't bemoan the darkness. I don't cringe at the evil. What I see is an opportunity for the soldiers of the Lord, his faithful servants, to march forward together, winning souls for Christ. That's the call. In an age of darkness, so many people are crying out for help, but if we're not out there, we won't know that. Because I'll tell you something, the day and age of people who are lost, goats, wandering in here just out of curiosity are over. Nobody's going to check a church out today if they're lost. The deception is deep and it's wide. And lost people have no use for the church. They've been lied to about what the real church is. The real church is a place where we can gather, where we can encourage one another, where we can be there for each other, building each other up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. The real church, brothers and sisters, is a family. It's a body. We share life together. I encourage you, and we're going to begin to do this, and I'll share more later, but as I've prayed about this and thought about this past weekend and received a fresh understanding and vision from the Lord for this particular body of believers, we're going to begin to implement some of these things, and we're going to do so on a regular basis. We want to be found faithful when the Lord returns. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so very, very blessed so thankful. Lord, forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us, Lord, of all unrighteousness. In thought, word, or deed. And Father, make us suitable for your use. And Lord, as we begin to think on these things and to put them into play, we pray that we would always do so under the authority and by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for allowing us this great honor and blessing to participate in you with the work that you desire to do here in Lima. And I know, Lord, that it will spill over into other places. For you said to your followers that we shall be your witnesses in Lima and Ohio, in the United States, and internationally, in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and the other parts of the world. Thank you, Father. Lord, we will be quick to give you glory and honor and praise. We will walk day by day in obedience to you. And we ask, Lord, for your favor upon us. Father, those of our number that might be struggling with any issue, we ask that you would break, bind, disperse any spirit of oppression. Lord, make us all of one accord, of one mind, moving forward. We love you, Lord. We praise you and thank you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.